To the Philippine Benchmark Index now, the PSEI closes lower for a third straight session. The local bourse ended today's trade at 65.01 after shedding a percent. Value turnover was at 5.3 billion pesos. Alfred Garcia of AP Securities Incorporated now joins us for a discussion on today's trade. Hi, Alfred. Good afternoon.
Hi, Stanley. Good afternoon.
All right. We're speaking to analyst Ferdinand Subido on Market Edge this morning, and he was telling me there isn't much change in terms of House consensus for GDP this year, which is slightly below the 6-7% target by the government. He said it would be 5.7 really for 2024. Now, do you share the same view now? And what indicators are you watching that may impede this kind of finish?
Yes, Ellie. So our team is forecasting for GDP to be between 5.6 to 5.9% this year, which is actually lower than the 5.8 to 6.2 that we forecasted earlier, right. Earlier this year. And this already factors in the elevated prices and delayed rate cuts. So you could say that this is already the impeded scenario. We're already seeing a slowdown in consumer spending, which is basically the cornerstone of our economy, as well as capital formation. So further slowdown in these two segments would definitely weigh heavily on our GDP figures moving forward.
All right, so you have revised, and the BSP, in fact, has sounded off possible rate cuts now by the third or the last quarter of the year. But there are a few analysts who are seeing very minimal cuts really this year, somewhere like 25 and then another 100 basis points in 2025. Now, where do you stand on this?
Okay, so our base case scenario is for 50 bips of rate cuts this year. But at this point, well, we're already getting a taste of what it means for the peso if we cut ahead
ahead
of the Fed.
Right.
So yeah, as much as we would like to think that the BSP can move independently of the Federal Reserve, it's increasingly becoming clear that the Fed's move should also be considered. So it's a possibility that we might be cutting 25 bips only, or maybe no rate cut for the year. So we're also preparing for that scenario. And if they continue to remain hawkish, the Fed, I mean, we might actually have no choice but to push back our own rate cuts.
Yeah, of course, the BSP is maintaining that the cutting would still be dependent on data, but some analysts are seeing possible inflation swings already in the next 3 months or so, and that's on account of El Nino. You have power, food, and fuel prices rising. Now, how significantly would these price rises impact rate cutting timelines now?
Actually, our base case of a first cut in September or October already takes this into consideration. We're fairly confident that slowing inflation in July onwards would be enough to offset the expected upticks in the next 3 months. So we think that these increase in inflation in the next 3 months would affect the timeline.
All right, it would. In fact, let's talk about markets now. This will be a quiet week, really, on the local data front. But U.S. PCE by Thursday and GDP by Friday may, of course, influence foreign money flows in or out of the market. What do better inflation and better U.S. GDP data do to investments in emerging markets? Now, talking about inflows and outflows.
Okay, so these two data points are basically what the Fed considers when deciding their monetary policy. So if we get data that further feeds into the hawkish narrative of the Fed, we'll hear more about the higher for longer rates. And this would again keep the risk-free U.S. treasuries more attractive as compared to riskier emerging market assets like ours. So this might trigger another wave of foreign outflows as foreign funds go into to better returns in a more risk-free environment.
All right, let's look at the market now. In today's trading, Alfred, share prices have been pulled back near the support threshold. I mean, we've been hoping it would hold, but if 6,500 is already breached, would you say that this market is entering a deeper correction? Or to what levels are you seeing the lows in near term?
Indeed, our close for today is very dangerously close to that key support level at 6.5. Yeah. So a breach below these levels could potentially lead to a retest of the medium-term support levels that we've been watching, which is 6.350 and even 6.180. So it's a make or break level for us. Yeah. So we need to stay above that 6.5 level.
This is already our third day of loss, Alfred, if you look at the trends. What influenced today's trading to arrive at that kind of outcome? More than what, 1% down from yesterday's close?
Yes, I think the market is still continually pricing the changing scenarios when it comes to rate cuts. We're not getting a clear direction yet, so that's why we're getting these wild swings recently. And also the peso has been, well, the dollar has been strengthening against the peso, whichever way you look at it. So this also affects the outlook for Philippine companies.
All right, Alfred, let's look at some business stories of the day, beginning with Meralco, up for franchise renewal with the Senate seeking a performance assessment of the company. Now, how do investors feel now about this, or not just for Meralco, but for other industries that are heavily regulated?
Well, definitely this is something that has been weighing on Meralco's share price recently, as we're just a few years away from the expiration of their franchise in 2028. And we have already seen in recent years, around 2018, what adverse government action can do to affect companies. So because of that, in-house, we've taken to applying a 15% regulatory risk discount when we're valuing companies that are heavily regulated by the government. So basically, this tempers our expectations. Mm-hmm.
And maybe you can give us an idea of the other companies or issues where you apply the 15% regulatory discount.
The other companies would be other utilities, so that would be like Manila Water,
okay,
and Synergy Grid, which is the parent of NGCP.
All right, on to another story. Alternergy securing a loan from BPI and Security Bank to partially finance wind projects in Tanay, Rizal. What does this mean for the company? Another renewable energy player in the country, which the government is encouraging.
Yes, it's very encouraging how these banks have been increasingly willing to fund the renewable energy companies. Well, we've been seeing a wave of project financing agreements recently, especially involving them. And it's very good for the company and for the industry in general, because if you look at it, most of the renewable energy companies are still in the process of building up their portfolio. So there's not much earnings history to show for it yet. So we really welcome that the banks are willing to fund them despite this lack of historical data.
All right. Lastly, Alfred, your trading guidance. You know, we're closing the month of May this week. I don't know how the landscape would be for June. In the coming week, but really, what has been your thoughts about this market and where is it headed right now?
I'm very cautious about the market, and as you said, it's a very quiet week on the economic data front, so most of the main movers would happen later this week, so mostly people have been staying away in the past few days, but I expect that we'll see some pickup in June, maybe.
Okay.
Although we'll have to wait first for our inflation figures, which is due to come out next week, Wednesday, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
So that's something that would really drive the market.
All right. On that note, Alfred Garcia, Research Head of AP Securities Incorporated, thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. Have a great day.
Good day, Stanley. Thank you for having me.
All right, we're stepping aside for a short break. When we return, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. signs the so-called Eddie Garcia Law. The details of that after this short breather. This is the Business Roadshow.